جانب دهورا ولهم عذاب واصب إلا من خطف الخطفة فأتبه شهاب ثاقب آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات. So the last slide, if I can remember on Wednesday, I left you was that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all people in Jannat, whatever it is, you've been told either one of them, they are telling us that once they are in Jannat and they see all the ni'mat in Jannat and realize that they would not be even, they would not experience another death, then they say that this is the best thing. And then we are told that in fact, because of that, we should also try to, no, this was the ayat. We said, no, أَفَمَا نَحْنُ مَيِّتِينَ. People in Jannat say that we are not going to taste the death any longer now because we died once. إِلَّا مَوْتَتَنَا الْأُولَى وَمَا نَحْنُ مُعَذِّبِينَ. Except for the first death which we experienced, nor are we going to be punished, because now they are in Jannat, they have been spared for the punishment. إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ فَوْزُ الْعَظِيمُ. Indeed, this is the greatest success, the greatest triumph, right? And then at the end, there is an ayat, beautiful. لِمِثْلِ هَذَا فَلْيَعْمَلِ الْعَامِلُونَ. No, let all the workers for the like of this should work, right? Let us all struggle for this, because this will bring about Jannah. And then we discuss in detail some of the reasons, some of the ways to attain Jannah. These are only few of them. We don't want to get into it, but we discussed that quite in detail last time. Now we go to the next verses, from 62 to 68. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أذلك خير نزلا أم شجرة الزكوم. This is another thing about the Quran. Quran has its own style of doing things. Many years ago, I read an article that Quran is not like any other book. And this is important because when we read the Quran, so often it's my experience that when I go to the communities, one of my first lectures is about the importance and necessity of reading the Quran. So there are some people in the audience, always, right? You find there are people who listened and try to follow and implement what we say. So then we find some of the youths start reading, some of the elders start reading. And then if I meet them again after some time, whether I'm visiting the Jamaat again or if I'm in the same town, I ask them, how are you progressing? Very few would say we continue. Many of them have stopped after, you know, reading a few pages or maybe a few days or a few, you know, times. They would not continue. So I tell them, why is it so? And their response is that Quran is not like in the book. We expect a Quran to be a book of story or book of, for example, textbook, right? No, it will have everything arranged. This is the chapter on wuzu. Maybe this is a chapter on the Prophet. This is a chapter on Imams. No, we find things here and there. So they are surprised. What is it? And this is because in the background, they did not have an idea that Quran is not like any other book. Quran has its own style. And it's a discussion on its own, right? Why it is so. So one of the styles of Quran is that we know Quran presents one aspect. Just now we discussed about Jannat and all the ni'mat of Jannat. Such until that we are told, لِمِثْلِ هَذَا فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَامِلُونَ, that no, for such a kind of situation, people should work hard. Immediately now, Quran is telling us the opposite. Now the stuff Quran, it talks about the opposite. So it says, أَذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ نُزُلًا أَمْ شَجَزَكُمْ. Now you decide, is that life in Jannat, whereby you are going to your provision, continuously ask whatever you want, is that better, or شَجَزَ زَكُّمْ, or the tree of Zakkum? Allah is asking question. And this is another style of the Quran. Quran often asks question to the audience. Why? Because Allah is inviting us to reflect, to think. One of the greatest ni'mat for a human being Allah has given is that brain, that, you know, whereby we can think and plan, right? So Quran is inviting us to think. Even the ayat, which is very popular, recited when somebody seeks, أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّءَ, is a question form. The first alif of أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ is a question. In Arabic, if you want to say, no, ask something, you start with alif of question. They say in Arabic, alif al-istifham, alif of asking questions. So Allah says, أَذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ. What we discussed just now about Jannat and people of Jannat and on the ni'mat they are going to, is that better? أَمْ شَزَكُمْ, or the tree of Zakkum. Now, what is tree of Zakkum? Inna ja'alnaha fitnatan lil-zalimin. This tree of Zakkum is actually a punishment and a trial for those who are doing zulm. Lil-zalimin. Now, mind it, zalimin is a very wide word. Zalimin is a proof of zalim. Zalim comes from one who does zulm. Zulm is doing wrong. Sometimes people think zulm is only somebody who is going to, for example, torture somebody, somebody is going to prison, or it only applies to those who are leaders, people like Saddam. No. We can also be doing zulm, na'udhu billah. Right? First of all, the definition of zulm in Arabic is something which is not put in its own place. So for example, this is a cape which is supposed to be put on my head, right? I take this cape and start putting on my foot. I start wearing on the foot, right? That is a zulm because it's a misplaced thing, right? So simple thing is that also is zulm. But zulm, in as far as we are concerned, is that how we interact with our own family members, how do we interact with our subordinates, right? How do we treat them? How, for example, we are raising our children? Do we really give them the right? Do we fulfill the right? Do we fulfill the rights of our relatives, of fellow mu'mineen, of the neighbors? All those things not doing can be zulm. Or zulm can also mean, for example, that when I take somebody's wealth and then do not give him back, or give him so late that it's no longer valuable, right? Or delay payments, or not give homes. All those can be part of zulm. So you can see, Allah says, "Inna ja'alnaha fitnatan lil-zalimin." We have made this tree of Zakkum. We'll come just now, what is it? As a trial, fitna is a trial. As a trial for those who are zalimin, wrongdoers. Innaha shajaratun takhruju fi aslil jahim. Now Allah is telling us, what is this tree of Zakkum? He says the root of this tree is completely from the bottom of Jahannam. So you can imagine Jahannam. In another place, Quran is telling us the Jahannam, the fire is such that its fuel is stones and human beings. You know? Quran is telling us, for example, when Allah says, "Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu, ku anfusakum, wa halikum nara." No. Ukuduhum hijaran, the fuel of that fire is stones, right? So that fire, which is can also burn stones, which will be there, right? The fuel of that will be stones. Imagine it's a tree which is growing from there. The roots are there. How much this tree would be, you know, that it can actually handle this fire, and from there the roots are there. So shajaratun takhruju fi aslil jahim, which is going to come out from the bottom of the Jahannam. Talhuha ka'annahu ru'usu shayateen. And as its branches and its fruits and, you know, stalks which are coming out, as if these are the heads of shayateen, you can see. فَإِنَّهُمْ لَآكِلُونَ مِنْهَا فَمَا لِعُونَ مِنْهَا الْبُتُونَ. Right? They are going to be eating from the tree, right? They will eat from the tree and gorge with their bellies. It will be just fill their bellies with them. Now the question comes, right? If something is so severe, why would even people eat? That will come, but we'll discuss this thing. No? But we have told, فَإِنَّهَا لَآكِلُونَ. They are going to eat, people of Jahannam are going to eat it, minha, from that. فَمَا لِيُمَا مِلْبُتُونَ. And then their stomachs will be filled with that. They'll be eating. There is no choice, they'll be eating, you can see. ثُمَّ إِنَّ لَهُمْ عَلَيْهَا لَشَوْبًا مِنْ حَمِيمٍ. On top of that, they'll take a solution from a scalding water. On top of that food from the shajar of Zakkum, from the tree of Zakkum, they'll be given water, which will be so hot, scalding water, right? Which will, for example, if today, if it were to just one drop were to put on my hand, it will burn everything. That is what scalding water is, right? So they'll be on top of that, no? Inna lahum alayha shawu nazim. Thumma inna marji'ahum la ilal jahim. Then their retreat will be towards hell. Again, there is no escape from that. The retreat they're going is from Jahannam. So up to now, the surah was discussing about the ne'mat of Jannat. Now Allah says, if you don't do those things, then this will be the outcome. Now you decide what is better. What is your choice? And that's why he's asking the question. Because brothers and sisters, don't forget, you know, Quran is telling us number of times that we have given you the choice. So often in our life, we ourselves go for wrong. We rarely, for example, somebody is compelled and forced. Only a child who is masoom, a child who is under his parents' influence, sometimes they are misled, right? But otherwise, as far as elders are concerned, we have the choice. And that's why Quran is asking the question that you tell, decide what is good. No? So question, to rebuke the guilty and other prophet, it has been questioned. That you can see the format is questioning just to rebuke the guilty and others to ponder. So either for us to ponder and those who are guilty for them to rebuke. Compare this with the food in paradise and hell. We discussed about the food in paradise earlier. In Surah 44 Ad-Dukhan, Subhanallah, a surah which we are going to recite inshallah on the nights of Qadr, but also it is mustahab to recite this surah before sleeping, Surah Ad-Dukhan, on its own, there are benefits. Allah says there, indeed the tree of Zakkum will be the food of the sinful. Like the molten copper, it will boil in their bellies, sitting like boiling water. Now imagine, Quran is telling us, this is directly from the Quran, a copper which is molten is in our stomach burning. Imagine what a person will be going through. This is really scary, and Quran is drawing that picture and scenario about Jahannam. You can see, like a molten copper, it will boil in the sitting like boiling water. This is what their food, right? Roots from the bottom of hell and nourished by the fire. That's because of that, right? Its fruit stalks are like heads of shaitan or snakes. One of the tafsir says it could also mean heads of shaitan or like snakes, right? Filled with bellies out of hunger or are forced to do so. So what is happening is that although it is such a bad thing, but even then they would eat because they'll be so hungry. So they will say, let us have it. Or they will be forced to eat it, right? When satiated, they feel a lot of thirst. But when they take this tree of Zakkum and they are filled, automatically their bellies will feel like having more water. And then they'll be fed with a brew of boiling water. So it's really scary and warning we've been given about Jahannam. Now we decide, do we want to go for that or not? And that's why, as we said last lecture on Wednesday, that this is the best time. And Prophet says this is the time for us to change. Month of Ramadan is the best time because we are fasting. Even if we, and you've noticed, I'm sure all of you have experienced, some of you are elder than me, some of you are my age, some of you are younger than me, that when we do wrong, especially in month of Ramadan, God forbid if I lie, God forbid, for example, if I backbite, God forbid, for example, I do zulm, I do something wrong, I do it, but then I feel, no, it's not right. At least in Ramadan, I should not do it, right? So you can see, automatically, this fast has that ability to tell you that what you are doing is not right. We are not easily just fooled into doing it. In other days, it's happened. And that's why, eating has so many positive but also negative outcomes. All of us need to eat to survive, right? We need to eat, for example, to enjoy our food, find all those things. But when the food is haram, when the food is najis, then the outcome and impact will be negative. There was, in fact, an alim who was so careful about what he eats, right? So careful, to the extent that he would be able to see beyond the physical thing on account of being careful. But once he was invited at somebody's place and they impress upon him that you must come to us and have a food with us, he went to that place, and because the food was not halal, he could see immediately in him that how his spirituality and his being changed. Now, of course, we don't realize because we are used to something wrong. For the first time when you eat something haram, you'll find that no. You'll immediately see that there is something wrong. So you have to be very careful, and you can see how Allah is telling us as far as the food of Jahannam is concerned. We continue next ayat, right? Innahum alfaw aba'ahum dhalin. They had found their fathers astray. Innahum alfaw aba'ahum dhalin. Fahum ala atharihim yahra'un. Yet they press onwards in their footsteps. Subhanallah. Allah says, they found innam alfa abaun dal. They already knew that our forefathers, our parents, our grandparents, our elders what they are doing is wrong. As I said in one of the lectures, that there are youths who come to us and says, Maulana, we sit on the table. We see our parents doing ghibat. We see this thing. We know it's wrong. What do we do? They are our parents. We can't just tell them you are wrong, or we can't start lecturing them. They would not like it. It's disrespectful. But you can see the youths see that thing. They realize it. You know, what kind of, you know, precedent we are setting, an example, right? So Allah says, "Innam alfa abam dal." They knew that their forefathers were dalin. That means they've gone astray. For om ala atharim, you know. Yet they press onwards on their foot. Yet they want to follow them. You know. If time comes for us to change certain things, let us change it. We cannot just say it has been happening. Let's do continue. No. Certain times things are different. We need to change, right? وَلَكَدْ دَلَّ قَبْلَهُمْ أَكْثَرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ Right? We are told most of the former people went astray before them. The same kind of practice. Today, for example, today you don't want to change. Even in the past, there were people who followed their forefathers. For example, when people came to the Prophet, when Prophet told them, leave aside all idols, stop worshipping God. And their argument continuously from Prophet Rasulullah, Prophet Ibrahim, all the way, their argument has been, are you telling us to leave something what our forefathers are doing it? How is it possible? You are wrong, you know. But you can see clearly. وَلَكَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا فِيهِمْ When Allah says, وَلَكَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا فِيهِمْ مُنْزِرِينَ But indeed, we have certainly sent warners to them. But the warners have come. Brothers, when we say munzirin, those who warn, does not necessarily has to be a prophet. As we know that Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as far as he is concerned, he is the last of the prophets. There is no prophet who is going to come, right? Quran is telling us clearly that Khatamun Nabiyyin, one of the things you'll find as we have this exhibition of Quran, of translations, we also have Quran from different schools of thought, Sunnis, Shias, Qadianis. If you take this ayat about Khatamun Anbiya, that means prophet is the seal of the prophet, right? He's the last of all the prophets. Clearly says, Khatama is seal. Even for example, when you sign a document and you want to seal, they say Khatama. So Khatamul Anbiya, right? The one who is seal of the prophets. In spite of that, there are translations. You go there, open the translation by other schools of thought. They have changed the meaning there. Why? Because they believe that another prophet had come. No, we believe that he was the last prophet. After him came the imams. And we know all this history, right? Each imam, how they came, how they were killed, until the 12th of them, who was born at the age of 5, when his father became Shaheed, the 11th imam, he went to Ghaibat. We know all those things, we hear about all those things. So there is no other imam also. Our imam is in Ghaibat. So Munzirin here does not necessarily mean that Allah is going to send you a prophet or an imam, no. Any warner, it can be your teacher, madrasa teacher, it can be your parent, it can be your maulana, it can be any speaker. It can be Quran also, right? That is just warn you. Allah says, وَلَكَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا فِيهِمْ مُنْزِرِينَ We indeed send them munzirin. فَانْدُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُنْزِرِينَ Right? But observe how was the fate of those who were warned, right? What was the fate of them? No? فَانْدُرْ كَيْفَ كَانَ عَاقِبَةُ الْمُنْزِرِينَ Right? إِلَّا عِبَادَ اللَّهِ الْمُخْلَصِينَ سُبْحَانَ Again Allah says, except for those who were mukhlisin. Sincerity. We discussed earlier also, again Allah says, except for those servants who are mukhlisin. And it is very important that we always struggle to be mukhlisin. It's not an easy thing. What is mukhlisin? Sincerity. Whatever we do, imagine a person does and does any good deed expecting nothing. Just we do it because it is good. If anything, Allah knows it, no, and He will reward. I don't expect anything from a human being. Don't do that. No, let's do only for the sake of Allah. And that we have to train. Otherwise, what will happen? That every time we expect people to praise us, reward us, then what will happen? That a time would come that we'll start doing wrong things. People will praise you, right? And you'll start doing even more. That no, in fact, you are doing this thing, right? Something which is wrong you are doing it, but they are praising you. Don't know. We will not do that, right? So, illa ibadullah mukhlisin, let us look at sincerity, how important it is. Although we can look at so many hadiths, but we have to maintain because of the time. Let's look at one hadith here and see if there is another. No? The sixth Imam, Imam Jafar Sadiq, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says this ayat number 2 of Surah Al-Mulk, when Allah says that He may try you to which of you is fairest in works. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, right? All of us know this, because when some death takes place, you'll find some speakers, when they talk about death, they use this thing. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Tabarak al-Ladhi biyadihi al-Mulku wa huwa ala kulli shayin qadir al-Ladhi khalaqa al-Mawt wal-Hayata liyabluwakum ayyukum ahsanu amala. So that He tries you, Allah tries you. He has created death and life so that He tries you. Who amongst you is most fairest in work? No? Now Imam is explaining. It does not mean one of you whose deeds are more numerous. It does not mean how much deeds you did. Allah is not concerned about the quantity, clearly you can see. It does not mean one of you whose deeds are more numerous, but one who is most rightful, more rightful in his conduct. And this rightness is nothing but the fear of Allah and sincerity of intention and fear. That we, every time we do, we are only preoccupied, oh Allah, do you really approve of this thing? Have I done this thing which pleases you? And how will that happen? We won't receive a text from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in my phone that, oh Hasnil, what you have done is right, right? That will not happen. The only way is for us to do something, sit aside, back and reflect on it. If you're not sure, we'll check with the scholars, right? But we will do things, yes. So there is that sincerity and fear of Allah, right? Whether I've done correct on. Then Imam added, to persevere in an action until it becomes sincere is more difficult. Listen to this, what Imam is saying, subhanAllah. To persevere in an action, right, until it becomes sincere is more difficult than performing the action itself. And sincerity of the action lies in this, that you should not desire anyone to praise you for it except Almighty Allah, and intention supersedes the action, right? So you can see intention supersedes the action. That means if the intention is good, then the action has a value. Otherwise, action is just an action. There's nothing in it. I have told you a number of times in one of the hadiths, we are told, a qari of Quran, the worst person who does nothing but he goes to people's house and recites Quran. That is, for example, his work. That is his task, right? You invite him today, somebody is getting married. There is some ceremony of your son or daughter. You invited a qari of Quran. Such qaris, on the day of judgment, when they will be taken for punishment, they will complain to Allah. They will say to Allah that, but you, why am I doing this? Why is it happening to me? I was a qari of Quran. I was not a singer. I was a qari of Quran. And Allah will tell them that you are qari of Quran so that people praise you. And they praise you. So that was your reward. Why are you asking reward from us? You wanted reward from people, they praise you. You wanted wah wah from them. They did that. Right? Why ask? So if we expect from people, then don't expect from Allah. Just expect from Allah subhanahu that, ya Allah, you are. So you can see Imam clearly says, that does not desire anyone to praise for it except God. On the contrary, brothers, and when sometimes you do something good, if somebody praises you, don't be happy. You know, don't allow him to continue doing that. Just try to change the topic. First of all, this is what Allah has done. Just pray for me. That's all. But if he continues praising, then actually he's embarrassing you. He's spoiling you. Don't allow that thing. It should not happen, right? You can see sincerity of actions and deeds. Imam Muhammad Baqir sallallahu alayhi, says, perseverance in an action is more difficult than the act itself, right? He was asked, what is meant by this? What is meant by perseverance in action? That we perceive, what is meant by? This is what Imam replied. A man does some kindness to a relative or expends something for the sake of Allah, who is one and has no partner. Thereupon, the reward of good deed performed secretly reason for, listen to this scenario, subhanAllah. When you give, when a person spends some kindness, you know, does a kindness to a relative, or spends in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is only one, right? And has no partner, Allah is one. Thereupon the reward of good deed is performed secretly, written for him. So when you do it secretly, Allah writes it. Later on, he mentions it to someone, and that which was written earlier is wiped out. So after I give sadaqah, now I come here and say, oh, I gave donation last night. Before coming, I gave donation. I'm announcing to everybody, right? Now, so what happens? Last night, when I came in and I gave the donation, only the person who received knew, nobody knew, I come and announce it, right? So if you were to do that, you know, that is wiped out already. And instead, the reward of a good deed performed openly is given to him. Now that reward, when a person performs the deed openly, he'll get less reward. That's right. Later, when he makes a mention of it again, the voice of Riya is written for him instead of the reward written earlier. So do you see this thing? That when we do something good secretly, we get, it's written there that we have done this thing secretly for us. When I mention it once to somebody, you know, already it goes one stage down. Then it goes and written that I have done it in a public. I mention it again that I have done this thing, then it's gone off. Do you see this thing? And I always say that when you do something good, so this is the month of charity, right? Khairat. If you can afford to do it, do it. Don't tell even your wife. Let her also do good thing. You know, for example, sometimes you say, oh, main de diya hai paisa jamaat mein. Paisa dejo nahi, double na tha mujhe. Let them do it, right? They want to do their own, they have their own earning. Even money which you give her, right? She uses for the household and then she sells. She wants to do khairat. Don't stop her for that. You do it, let her do it, right? So often people don't do it. It is something which is done secretly only for the sake of Allah. And the reward is there, right? So this is some of the things which we discussed earlier. When it comes to sincerity, we don't have much time. I'll just end here discussion. But keep this in mind that as we progress, and we have said that this surah is very important, you can imagine some of the rewards and merits. When this surah is recited over a dying person, Allah would make his death painless and easy. Do you realize now, we have been told earlier, remember, if you remember earlier, I had said that we had quoted and I'm glad, I was very pleased to hear that one brother came to me and said, what was the name of the book which you mentioned? So earlier, we had quoted from an Islamic laws, a masala, whereby Ayatollah Sistani says, in order to comfort a dying person, it is recommended to recite at his side the blessed surah of Yasin, As-Safat, Al-Ahzab, and to recite Ayatul Kursi, verse number 54 of Surah Al-A'raf, and the last three verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. So you can see, keep this masala in mind, and keep what we recited, right? That if you recite for a dying person, the hadith says, if a person is dying, and if you were to recite this surah, see the benefit. It would make his death painless and easy. Allah has decreed that death will come on that person. He has to die, right? But because you recited besides him, it will make that thing easier. And this is important. I don't know how many of you visit hospitals often. When we sometimes go to hospital and especially visit people who are terminally ill, they go through very difficult time. Those last moments is very difficult. So recite these surahs. And again, I'm repeating myself. Recite means recite yourself, not just run it what CD or run iPhone or MP3. No, recite yourself. That's what's required, right? Whoever recites this surah every Friday, we discuss this thing also, you know, would remain safe from every calamity and trouble, would receive enough means of livelihood. His property and his children would remain safe from enemies and the accursed shaitan. If he dies on the same day, that means after on the day he recited this surah, so for example on Friday or any day, he would die as a martyr, as a shaheed, and live in paradise amongst the martyrs. Paradise, you know, as Allah says, Allah says, those who are dying in the way of Allah, those who die in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are not dead, right? But ahya in the Rabbin, yurzakun, they are living in having the risk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this surah will have the ability that a person were to recite on Friday and God forbid if he die the same day, then he'll be counted amongst those who are shuhada, right? Finally, whoso recites this surah, Allah would credit him with virtues 10 times more than the number of all the jinns and humans. Now, remember I said on the first day, and again I'm repeating, Ayatullah Nasir Makarim Shirazi, who has edited the tafsir known as Tafsir Namune. Many of us know about this tafsir work. It is in about 27 volumes, and it is appearing, it was done in Farsi, then translated into Arabic, and also Urdu. Unfortunately, in English, only parts of them have been translated. Whenever he mentions this kind of hadith about the merits of reciting surahs, he says, he puts a footnote there. He says, the reward of these will be only had by those who recite these surahs, understand them, and try to follow on them. So the idea is for us to recite, internalize this thing. And this is exactly why we have these sessions of tafsir now or later on, that this Quran is full of knowledge, full of what wisdom and philosophy and all those things. It is important that we do recite them, try to understand them. Another thing, of course, if you come to the exhibition, you will see there are so many translations available out there in the market. Maybe you go and look at them. What may appeal you? Certain language you may like, certain language you don't like. There are some simpler translations. There are translations for children. People have done Quran translation for children. So they will try to use language which is easier. Then they have kept some kind of what boxes to explain the points. There are illustrations. So you can see all efforts are being done to convey the divine message to the humanity and especially to all of us. And finally, let me end this thing discussion, is that Quran has the ability to change the life of people. Quran has the ability to give you such kind of message that you'll be surprised how it changes you. You go online, you know, there is a site, Sound Vision. You go to Sound Vision, they have certain CDs and certain clips there, whereby they're given examples of people who became Muslims just by reading Quran. Just by reading Quran. You'll find, you say, a friend of mine one day brought a Quran to me. I kept it aside. It was lying with me for months and months. One fine day I said, let me just open it and have a look at it. Let me read it. And that person reads the Quran, and you find that the life has changed of that person. So he reads Quran once and his life changes. Imagine us who have Quran with us since our childhood. We went to madrasa when we were 3 years old, 4 years old. We went there, we were taught alif, ba, ta, sa. Up to now, Quran does not change us. How is it possible? When the outsiders read the translation, they change it. Right? That is possible. Quran has that ability. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may Allah give us tawfiq that we are able to recite the Quran regularly. Tomorrow, the lectures which we have got at the exhibition, there are two lectures on Quran itself. One is by Maulana Rizvi, which will be at 3 p.m., 3 to 4 p.m. Another is by Sheikh Khalil Jafar at 6:30 p.m. So try to make a point to be there. We have flyers there if anybody interested. It has all the information about the topics and when the lectures will take place. Try to be there and you'll see how much Quran has to offer. وَصَلِّ عَلَىٰ مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلِهِ الطَّاهِرِينَ اللَّهُمْ صَلِّ عَلَىٰ مُحَمَّدْ وَعَالِ مُحَمَّدْ رَحِمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ كَرَعَ الْفَاتِحَةِ بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين